Justice Brett Kavanaugh, who we just discussed, he came to today's hearing armed with a list of precedents that the Supreme Court has overturned in the past. Kavanaugh sounded quite different in his confirmation hearing 3 years ago, of course.
What would you say your position today is on a woman's right to choose?
Well, as a judge. As a judge, it is an important precedent of the Supreme Court. By it, I mean Roe v. Wade and Planned Parenthood versus Casey. Been reaffirmed many times. Casey is precedent on precedent, which itself is an important factor.
His comments on Roe v. Wade led key Republican Senator Susan Collins to vote for Kavanaugh's confirmation. Here's Collins in 2018 speaking about her sit-down with Kavanaugh.
We talked about whether he considered Roe to be settled law. He said that he agreed with what Justice Roberts said at his nomination hearing, in which he said that it was settled law.
CNN's Manu Raju joins us live. And Manu, there's no nice way to say this. Kavanaugh sounded very different on the subject of precedent today than he did when he was trying to get Susan Collins to vote for him. How did she respond to today's oral arguments?
Well, she said she didn't see it. She told her colleague, Ali Zaslav, I did not see his questioning or hear any of the arguments. I hope to later tonight play them so that I have firsthand knowledge of what the arguments were today, but I can't comment on what I didn't see. Now, recall how critical Susan Collins was to the confirmation of Brett Kavanaugh. He was confirmed 50-48. There were three Republican senators whose votes were in play. One of them was Jeff Flake of Arizona. He sat on the Senate Judiciary Committee. He was one of the first of those three to say that he would vote yes. He voted for that. Lisa Murkowski, the Alaska Republican, she voted against Brett Kavanaugh. And all eyes at the time were on Susan Collins. Collins was listening to the testimony of Christine Blasey Ford, who accused Brett Kavanaugh of sexual assault. Brett Kavanaugh, of course, denied that. She had meetings with Kavanaugh and talked about abortion because Collins supports abortion rights. And those comments that she heard from Kavanaugh, that he contended it to be, quote, settled law, was significant, pivotal for Collins to ultimately vote yes. And ultimately, after she went to the Senate floor, said she would vote for Kavanaugh, that immediately after it may have triggered the support of a key Democratic Senator, Joe Manchin, who said that he also would support Kavanaugh, who was narrowly confirmed by the Senate after that intense confirmation proceeding. But now in the aftermath of this, perhaps Kavanaugh could be a decisive vote striking down Roe. At that point, we'll see what Collins has to say.
Kavanaugh presented a list of cases where the Supreme Court overturned long-held precedents. What happened to Senator Collins assuring people Kavanaugh thought Roe was settled law?
Well, listen, I think she was much more gullible than, for instance, Dianne Feinstein, who said, listen, she's had many people come before Congress who wanted to get on the Supreme Court and said, you know, they believed in the principle of stare decisis and precedent takes precedent and not overturning precedent. And she's seen those same judges go and overturn precedent. So she was much more skeptical of what Kavanaugh was saying. And you had, of course, there with Collins believing what Kavanaugh said. Listen, I think what is most important here is what did Donald Trump say in 2016? He was going to appoint justices to the Supreme Court that would overturn Roe v. Wade. It's why many Republicans supported him in 2016 and continue to support him. So guess what? He appointed three justices there to fulfill his campaign promise. And it certainly looks like if you listen to some of the questioning today, if you look at the background of the Trump justices, it certainly looks like they are prepared not only to affirm the Mississippi law banning abortion beyond 15 weeks, but also overturn Roe versus Wade. This is what they are there to do. It's been a long, long, decades-long, 50-year battle for conservatives and Republicans. And so now they have the opportunity to make good on this fight.
I want to put up this map, Laura, and if the court was to reverse Roe v. Wade, 26 states are certain or likely to ban abortion almost immediately. So take Louisiana as an example. The nearest clinic for three and five women would be in Illinois. And for the rest of the women, it would be Kansas or North Carolina. It is a drastic shift. Who's going to have the most impact here?
people who are not able to travel in order to make medical decisions or act on informed medical decisions, people who do not have the resources to do it, it'll fall disparately on women of color and people of color in general who are more likely to fall in that category. This is not to suggest, and I want to be very clear, whenever I hear this argument be made that abortion restrictions will overwhelmingly impact women of color and black women, it's not to suggest, and nor should anyone suggest, that only black women or women of color are having abortions. Mm-hmm. This is a very universalized experience for women, but it's oftentimes talked about as if it only impacts. But it does have a disparate impact because of socioeconomic factors here.
Resources.
But remember, one of the real issues here that's so important to think about are the reasons that Supreme Court justices are even thinking about possibly overturning Roe v. Wade. Take Justice Amy Coney Barrett, for example, who said, well, I don't understand, I'm paraphrasing here, don't the safe haven laws get to the issue that you want to address? Safe haven laws being you can hand your newborn into a safe space without penalty of having abandoned your child. If you terminate your parental rights, isn't that the same thing as terminating one's pregnancy because there's a different burden at stake here? It's a fundamental misconception of what is being talked about. The idea that you're going to say, as long as you can terminate parental rights and put your child up for adoption, that is the same thing as being able to have the choice and agency to terminate one's pregnancy, is so flawed. So is Justice Kavanaugh's thought here, Don, where he suggests that maybe the Supreme Court just ought to be neutral. Well, I want a Supreme Court that's neutral, said no one ever. The whole role of the judicial nine is to be able to be decisive and make decisions where the lower courts particularly have conflict. And in Mississippi, there has been no conflict. Courts have said, the lower courts have said, it's unconstitutional. So by virtue of even taking this case, Don, you already see the leanings.
Yeah, and perhaps you're right about people of color or women of color. It's a resource issue, and maybe it should be women of color and poor people of, or poor women of every different ethnicity.
It affects women. That's what people can think about. It affects women, and women ought to have the same rights as men. Mm-hmm. No one's curtailing the use of vasectomies. No one's talking about what men are able to do. So just to put it in the language of how it only will impact one race or another, it impacts the gender that is women.
Yeah. Nia, I'll give you the last word here.
No, I think that's right. And if you look at the reasons a lot of women get abortions, they're economic reasons. Some of these women already have kids, so they know about the burdens of parenting. A lot of these women are unmarried as well. And this is across all socioeconomic and racial lines as well. You had one of the people fighting to overturn Roe v. Wade said, well, listen, society is set up now where, you know, states help women with childcare. And they get leave. Well, they don't get paid leave, right? If you work at the Winn-Dixie in Mississippi and you become pregnant and you need to take time off because of your health during that pregnancy, or when you have the baby, your employer is very unlikely to give you paid leave to take care of that child. So this is, you know, there is a fundamental misunderstanding, I think, of the ways women go about their childbearing decisions and sort of the dilemmas they face when it comes to abortion.